If you're in school, you learn via textbooks or Wikipedia, but still a lot of textbooks. And for a long time in America, one of the big issues has been that textbooks are not written necessarily by the best minds. They tend to come out of very conservative states like Texas, most notably, and that colors the sorts of things that get taught and what doesn't get taught. But there I'm mostly generally just talking about sort of normal political bias, which is terrible and helps to erase a lot of the worst instances in our history. But sometimes it goes even farther. So I want to show you the results of an analysis by The Guardian that's been looking into the sorts of books that are used in many private schools. So mainly Christian schools. They reviewed dozens of textbooks produced by the Christian textbook publishers Abika, Bob Jones University Press, and the Accelerated Christian Education, three of the most popular textbook sources used in private schools throughout the US. So how popular? Well, with the first, they claim that 1 million Christian school students used them back in 2017. And the Accelerated Christian Education site says that tens of thousands of schools and homeschools in 140 different countries use their books. In fact, the HuffPost did an investigation back in 2017 and they found that at least 1/3 of all of the private voucher schools throughout the US use a curricula from one of the three sources that are going to be cited here. And that isn't even getting into those of those who don't use the voucher program. So this is something that potentially is reaching thousands and thousands of different schools. So what are some of the things that you might be learning if these are the books that are used in a school that you go to? Well, one Accelerated Christian Education high school textbook says that, quote, "The end of slavery in this country was a legitimate goal, but much was done in the name of abolition that was as evil as the institution of slavery itself." It contains a section titled Black Immigration, referring to slavery, which notes, quote, "Not all immigrants have come to America willingly." So let's pause there, Ben. That certainly has a spin on it. So much spin that it would be difficult to actually read the book. But to say that what was done in the cause of abolition was as evil as hundreds of years of slavery is a pretty bold claim.
The United States is the only society in the history of the world, and my undergraduate degree is in social sciences with a focus on anthropology. So if somebody can provide me an example, I might be wrong, but to my knowledge, the United States is the only society in the history of the world that has had literal human farms where people were sexually assaulted and forced to have children so that people would have more slaves. I don't think anything in the abolition movement adds up to anything like that. I think very few things do.
Oh, look, I want to believe you. You sound so persuasive, but you're not a textbook. And I read in a book that abolition was as evil. No, you're totally right. The issue is that, like a 9-year-old, an 11-year-old is just going to accept it. They don't know about that. They're certainly not going to be taught in these books about the systematized rape and destruction of families and all of that. But it goes further. Here's a section from an Accelerated Christian Education textbook. "Under radical reconstruction, the South suffered. Great Southern leaders and much of the old aristocracy were unable to vote or hold office. The result was that state legislatures were filled with illiterate or incompetent men. Northerners who were eager to make money or gain power during the crisis rushed to the South. For all these reasons, Reconstruction led to graft and corruption and reckless spending. In retaliation, many Southerners formed secret organizations to protect themselves and their society from anarchy. Among these groups was the Ku Klux Klan, a clandestine group of white men who went forth at night dressed in white sheets and pointed white hoods." Wow. So Reconstruction was radical and it took all of society's best, people who'd formerly served in the Confederates and slaveholders, things like that, filled the government with dummies who didn't believe that there should be slaves. And then because there was such anarchy, what else was there to be done but form domestic terror groups like the KKK? And again, Ben, a kid reading this, probably this is the only information they've ever received about these topics. I worry that they are just going to soak it up. That's what they're going to believe is true.
Yeah, that's terrifying. That's literally terrifying, because that is like a ridiculous way to like first like calling the elected the, because to be clear, there's like a lot of states in the South that had a bunch of newly elected black representatives who freed from slavery, went and got elected. And the KKK was literally one of many literal murder squads that would murder those people very publicly. And they also, right, if you want to talk about rigged elections in the United States, elections in the South up until, I think it was almost the 1940s or something like that, were notoriously rigged, where the Ku Klux took that, the Klan would literally roll in and like steal ballot boxes, they would stuff ballots. There was notoriously a town where there were more votes cast than people, not just adults, but people, period, that lived in the town, right? That was a huge part of American history in the South. And like, if this is the only thing a kid is learning about it, like it's just, it is brain melting. This is literally brain melting.
you're totally right about the effect on democracy. And then of course there's the race-based massacres. There was the wiping out of an entire town government that had elected black representatives. But no, it was necessary, because they were worried about anarchy. And if anarchy is like not following the law, it kind of seems like a vigilante squad lynching people illegally isn't really defending against anarchy so much as causing it. But anyway, look, that is talking about things from a long time ago. And I believe we need to have an accurate understanding of our history, but we also need to have an accurate understanding about what's happening now. And unfortunately, the books are no better when it comes to that. So the Bob Jones World History textbook says, unfortunately, Americans' view of race relations declined after Obama came into office. Race riots in places such as Ferguson, Missouri, and Baltimore, Maryland greatly escalated racial tensions and worsened strife between minorities and local police. President Obama's attempts to resolve these problems often seemed to make the situation worse. And Abeka says, groups such as Black Lives Matter sharpened the divide between police and citizen and black and white with divisive rhetoric. So yeah, like whether it's the origin story of the KKK or protests that continue to this day, it is framing things in a way that makes those who were fighting for equity and justice, they were the ones that were anarchists, they were the ones that were divisive. If it's getting worse, it's because of them.
Yeah, I mean, and let's talk about recent, right, United States history, right? 40 years ago in the 80s. In the 80s is when sundown towns in the United States reached their peaks. If you don't know what a sundown town is, chat, a sundown town is a town where people of color were literally systematically either murdered or arrested simply for being in the town after sundown, hence its name. They reached their peak in the 80s, okay, in the 80s, right? 40 years ago. That means many of the people, okay, who are old enough to have written these textbooks were alive and very much likely in their adulthood at the time when these sundown towns were at their peak, which means, to be very clear, they're very aware of it and B, might have some sympathies for perhaps their cousins, brothers, uncles, whoever might have participated in that.
Yeah.
And that's like, those people are very much alive today.
Yeah, you're 100% right. Or like you tell a great story, I'll tell a different one. So some black Americans would venture into sundown towns causing tension with local police. That's the way they would cover it in their school books. It's absolute madness. Now, very briefly, they do go even further back in history. So for instance, accelerated Christian education textbook, if you want to learn about early man, you can see as they snuck up on the wily brontosaurus, wearing jeans and wielding swords. Okay, so there weren't men at the same time as dinosaurs. I think we all know that. And to the extent that there were like men eventually, jeans are more recent. I will say though, I was very disappointed because there is so little that is true in that image that I assumed, and I almost wanted it to be true, to be totally perfect. I was like, I bet you the Stegosaurus and the Brontosaurus are separated by like 100 million years, but no, they were concurrent. They got that one right. But that's the only thing in that image that's actually accurate, Ben.
Yeah, I do have a confession. Now that we're at the young earth stuff, this is my confession. In high school, I went to a public school, but after school, I may or may not have been very religious and gone out of my way to do like after school religious classes that were very much like, and remember kids, harass your teachers and tell them that the world is 3,000 years old.
Oh God. Causing tension with local teachers. For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.